Just thanking Enrico for the previous, for the interesting previous presentation and for the support for to this webinar. And just to say thank also to Andrea, that is the co-organizer of this meeting along with me, and he made a fantastic work. So thank you, Andrea. So just to say it in public. And yeah, let's start with this presentation. My presentation. That. Test two. I see. Okay, my monitor seems to be stuck. Andrea, non so quello che vedete. Vedo tutto
Allora,
bloccato.
vediamo la slide introduttiva del webinar col titolo.
Ok, no. Adesso va, ok, I don't seem to go. Ok. Yeah, my presentation is about it's an introduction about the fatigue behavior of nickel-based superalloys produced by SLM. It will be most a qualitative presentation. I don't want to take too much time for the quantitative aspect that will be dealt with in the successive presentation. I just want to point out some important aspects that are that key aspect for the fatigue behavior components produced by SLM. Just a further introduction to the one just made by Enrico, in particular to ease the comprehension also for the one that are not expert of this sector. So just to start, let's just to start to see some industrial components, industrial application of nickel-based superalloys produced by additive manufacturing, in particular by SLM. Here we can see a heat exchanger produced by Renishaw, as example. Here we can see the complex geometries, the fine detail, the small parts, and the convoluted geometries. This is a key aspect of additive manufacturing and in particular power bed processes. The ability to produce complex components with convoluted shape, tangled internal channels, something that is almost impossible to be produced with traditional manufacturing processes, or that is possible to produce but only producing a lot of small parts that have to be then assembled. As example, in another famous component that is produced by additive manufacturing, as example, the one that you can see here on the left, that is a fuel nozzle produced by AVIO Aero and the company of GE Aviation, that is a fuel nozzle of a gas turbine of the LEAP engine produced by GE Aviation. Here we can see that in the past that component was produced in several parts that has to be assembled. Thanks to additive manufacturing, it's possible to produce it as one piece. Obviously, you can see the surface finish produced by additive manufacturing in the central part of the nozzle. On the connection part, it had to be machined in order to increase the dimensional accuracy. But here you can see a component that is heavily stressed, in particular by thermal loads, because it's the nozzle that where the flame in the gas turbine origins. And on the right, you see another component that is produced not by SLM but EBM, that is a almost similar production technology that are turbine blades produced in titanium alloys by the same companies, another famous component produced by additive. And you can see that how can be complex the shape, the component that is not a very big component, heavily stressed. If you think that turbine blades, even in the latest stage of the turbine, are heavily stressed by thermal loads and by centrifugal load, mechanical loads. So a technology that demonstrates to be ready for production of structural components, and where the fatigue strength of this component became crucial for the spread of this technology. Yeah, just to take a summary about what additive manufacturing means and the potentiality. It is an emerging technology for production, as we see, of production for the production of complex components. Complex components means components that are an assembly, are a unique part that substitute an assembly of one piece components, of small components, and now we can produce it just in one piece in order to reduce the complexity, but also to increase, for example, the strength of the component, avoiding a lot of connection that can create problems in operating conditions. We can start to produce new geometry that what are unfeasible with traditional processes, such as tangled internal channels that were impossible to drill or impossible to produce by die casting, as an example, and lattice structures. So structures that are intrinsically possible only with this technology that can lead to lightweight structure, to interesting biomedical application, particularly when printed in titanium and not in nickel-based alloys, obviously. And it's a technology that is crucial for the production of components that have to be produced in as a limited number of parts or product-specific geometries, so spare parts and so on. And nickel alloys are probably one of the material that is most suitable for additive manufacturing, in particular because nickel alloys are used in heavy operating condition for high stress components that are subjected to elevated temperatures, where the complex geometries are necessary, where internal cooling channels are necessary in order to have the metal temperature at temperature that the metal can sustain, as example in a gas turbine where the turbine blades, for example, are cooled by internal channels in order to sustain the heavy the elevated temperatures of the gas flow that are impossible for every material. And the alloys that are produced with nickel alloys that produced with additive manufacturing in this moment are alloys with equiaxial grains, so the alloys that were typical for welding application, Inconel 718 and the Inconel alloy. Other materials that for one is familiar with nickel alloys, such as directionally solidified alloys or single crystal alloys, are obviously impossible to be produced with additive manufacturing. As Enrico said before, we have a fine microstructure with fine grains, so this microstructure is intrinsically typical of additive manufacturing. We see that with the structural components produced by additive manufacturing, we have huge design flexibility, but this huge design flexibility involves the presence of a lot of notches, such as grooves, holes, lattice structure, and so we see multiaxial stress that arise from stress concentration effects. So multiaxial stress that arise from notches. And this is a key for the fatigue assessment of SLM manufactured components, for example. And on the other side, we have the technology that has inherent technological defects that are characteristic that we have to deal with in order to have an assessment of the fatigue behavior of this component. As Enrico showed before, internal porosity, lack of fusion, hot cracks, but also elevated residual stress. I show here just a picture of a cantilever beam that will be deeply stressed and explained by the successive presentation of Mattia Moda by the end of this seminar. And here you can see how a cantilever beam, after the removal of the support that hold this cantilever beam to the support plate during the manufacturing, you can see with the deflection of the beam how intense and severe are the internal stress within the component. That's just to make it visible. And we have in addition to this, we have also the effect of the surface finish that in the as-built condition is intrinsically poorer than machined parts. Just to pass to our first test campaign to see how we can deal with the fatigue assessment of additive manufacturing components, I'll show here just briefly a fatigue campaign on round specimen produced as plain specimen and notched specimen with different notch ready, obviously optimized, defined by finite element modeling in order to have a specific sense concentration effect at the notch apex. So with concentration, with the sense concentration factor between 1.6 to 2.7. And all this campaign that I'll show you in the further slide deals with as-built specimen. So surface condition is as-built and the parts were not post-processed with heat treatments that can be applied to this material. So we see the microstructure, everything that is peculiar of the as-built condition. So as the components are produced by the SLM machine, All these components were printed with a Renishaw Ren-M 500E SLM machine. The tests are carried out at room temperature. We see about the S-built surface, what means, just to show you what is. Here you can see in the top part, you can see the plain specimen, the classic specimen that we are familiar with, and you'll see discarding the threads at the end that are needed for holding it in the machine. Here you see the surface finish that is typical of the SLM process. You see a good dimensional accuracy for the dimension of this specimen that is almost 6 millimeter diameter. We see that if we see at a tolerance grade, it's almost NT10. So the tolerance grade is very good. The accuracy is very good. But we see that we have an elevated roughness if compared to machine surface. Here in the lower part, you see the notch produced by additive manufacturing and the other part of the specimen that was machined after the production. And here you can see the difference that is typical from a turning operation and the S-built surface. It's a clear, visible trace of the process. And obviously, the traces that you see are the traces of the stack of surface layer, of the stack of layers that are typical of additive manufacturing. This is an intrinsic characteristic of the technology that we can avoid only machining the part after the production. But machining is not every time possible because we have a lot of surface that cannot be machined. And so we have to deal with the fatigue assessment of this as-built surface, of this rough surface. Another aspect that we can see here is just a focus on the notch area. We see that there is a difference if we continue to build the part growing from the metal specimen below, and so that what is called the upskin part, where the surface finish is very good, compared to the opposite that happens when we have a diverging cone that is built on the powder bed. And we can see that here the surface quality is lower, is much poorer than the other one, and this involves effect on the, for example, on the onset of the fatigue crack, that we see that the fracture surface is not in the middle of the notch, but it's moved towards the downskin part in almost each specimen that we test, with a small difference due to the amount of the radii at the notch apex, but more almost in each time we can see this is infected. It's intrinsic due to the technology, and when we carry out the fatigue assessment of a component produced by SLM, we have to deal with this effect. Just to see a scanning electron image of the downskin surface, we can see here that we have, it's evident the trace of the stack of layers. We see that there is also of the poor surface quality that we see is due only to powder particles that are partially melted and attached to the surface but are not integral with the surface. So we saw also a visible roughness that is even worse than the one that is effective and the one that the material fills. But also these powder particles can contribute to create stress concentration. But in particular, you see here, as an example, that this superposition of layers that grow on the powder bed create small cracks, small liquefaction parts that can be the origin of the fatigue crack. And so it's an important effect. Just to see some microstructures that we can see. This is a microstructure obtained in with a surface orthogonal to the build direction. Here, in fact, you can see the stripes that you can see on the right are the scan lines where the part that is less dark, it's the center of the melt pool, and you see the darker part that is the boundaries of the melt pool of each scan line, where the precipitate tend to segregate. This is considered is an Inconel 718 alloy without post-heat treatment, so where the precipitate has still to grow, has to during usually it's done during the aging treatment. This is, was not aged, this material. So see that the material is intrinsically inhomogeneous. We see the trace of the production of the SLM process. This is a microstructure taken in the with a surface parallel to the build direction. You can see the build direction is in the right part, in the bottom part. You see the boundaries of the mesh pool, so it's visible how the surf the material that we create by SLM is the superposition of successive scan lines in the same plane, and then stack of layers. And this microstructure, this critical inhomogeneous structure, is something intrinsic that we have to deal with. But and in addition, you see, as Enrico said before, the columnar grains. You'll see that the columnar structure of the materials. You see the less dark area of the with the color, contrast color. You can see that are structures that are grows towards along the vertical direction and that cross the mesh pool boundaries. So the structure that we obtain, the columnar grain that we obtain, are greater than the mesh pool boundaries. Obviously, these images were obtained by etching the surface by the classical etchant used for nickel-based superalloys. Just to see the comparison with a wrought material and an additive manufacturing material, see that in a wrought material, you see discarding the precipitates, the orange and pink particle that you see that are due to the aging treatment, that here in a spread and here the precipitate are disaggregated because the aging is still to be carried out. But you see that while on the wrought material, we see almost homogeneous material where and the grain boundaries typical of the nickel-based superalloys. In the additive manufacturing material, we'll see microstructure that is finer but less homogeneous. This is intrinsic. Just a quick overview about how we can carry out a fatigue assessment, just to introduce the strain energy density concept. Strain energy density is the idea work dealing with the fatigue assessment by strain energy density means focusing on the fact that fatigue life is not governed only by the peak stress that we see, as example, in the Nochepex. We saw that the surface condition is fundamental and that we have to carry out the assessment taking into account the average stress that we have within a material depending control, but a material control volume that is surrounding the Nochepex. So we have to take into account the average stress in the area surrounding the point where we have the peak stress, because we cannot have the crack growth exactly where we have the maximum stress. We can have a small defect in an area that is near to the one that we are evaluating, and so we see that it's impossible to deal directly with peak stress directly, as it was only a static assessment. And we need something that is a bit defect tolerant, let's say, as approach. Just to explain the picture on the right, we see just the section of the specimen with in red. We see the area of the control volume that we taken for averaging the stress. And if we see the fatigue results obtained for this material with this approach, we see that it's possible to collapse almost all the fatigue data with almost a master curve with that condense the effect that we have for different notch radius example. And we see here on the right where we have some quantitative aspects that different notch radii that are characterized by different stress concentration effects tend to collapse in a unique framework if we deal with them in this approach. Just another thing to point out, we see the notch sensitivity. We see that the Q factor is very low. It's almost 0.2. That is very low, and it's due to the surface effect. The material doesn't is affected by the notch, the macroscopic notch that we introduce, but it's mostly affected by the roughness of the surface. Just to see how the brief fractographic analysis, we saw that in almost all the specimens that we tested, the surface, the crack concept originated from the surface in smooth specimens from just one point, in notched specimens from several incision sites due to the poor surface condition in the, as I said before, in the Voo notch. And if we enlarge the view and we zoom it with a scanning electron microscope, we saw that the fatigue crack has an onset from, it's confirmed that the onset was on the surface. We see that there is no macroscopic effect. So this specimen has no great no important porosity, no lack of fusion defect. It's simply the roughness of the material that affects the fatigue life of the component. So we have to understand how to deal with surface roughness of these components when we want to carry out an fatigue assessment. Just to conclude, we saw a particular preliminary validation of the possibility to employ average strain energy density for the fatigue assessment of additive manufactured component. It was just an overview. For sure, next presentation will deeply investigate this. We saw that the surface finish is a key for the fatigue assessment of these materials, and we saw that this material with good optimized machine parameters, we can avoid lack of fusion, significant internal porosity. So the defect that were known as potential crack initiator for additive manufacturing materials are mostly overcome. The technology is ready for production. A lot of defects that were typical the previous year were overcome by the machine producers and by the research carried out on the machine parameters. Thank you to everybody for the attention.